The only way to show the solutions for a system of inequalities is to graph both of those inequalities. We have one that is y is greater than negative 4x. Okay, so we'll do that in black, and we'll do the other one. So, short version, we have a y-intercept of 0. We got a slope of negative 4. That's going to go to the right 1 and down 4. Okay, remember, because inequalities come, or graphs of inequalities in two variables come in two pieces, essentially. A line, okay? A line is a bunch of points. All those points are the points that solve, or that make that inequality what?
True.
Equal, right? Does equal mean true necessarily?
No.
Is it true in this case?
No.
We do not like the points on the line y equals negative 4x because it makes both sides of this inequality equal, and there is no equal condition. So we don't consider that. So we draw what kind of a line? A line to show that we are not including these points in the graph. Okay, so we're going to OK dotted line. All right, and then there is the other part, the part 2 of 2, the blacked out half, blacked out by a bunch of points. And these points don't make both sides equal, they make both sides what?
True.
Yeah, true, right? Not equal. But there's two ways it could be not equal. This side could be smaller, or this side could be greater. We want it to be greater, so we'll shade in all the points that make that side greater. And where do those points come from? What's that?
You didn't say.
Oh.
Just yawning.
Okay. Josie.
Above.
Above, yeah. Above, because y is greater. Y is vertical. And vertically, the greater numbers come from up. There they are. All of these points that I'm trying to draw your attention to by sort of shading this in, all these points, if I choose, say, one at random, this one at 5, 5, that point in this shaded area, this blacked out half, if I plug it in, it'll make it true. It should, right? Negative 4 times 5, I have to choose an x and a y that would be the same. Is 5 greater than negative 20?
Yes.
Yeah, so just confirmation we did shade the right side. By the way, there's another way we can decide which side should be the blacked out half. Just try a point without knowing which side is supposed to be shaded. All right. If I hadn't shaded this already, testing this 0.55 tells me that point right there above the line comes from the shaded half, so shaded the rest of that half. And we'll do the other one in orange. Y, okay, negative 4x plus y is greater than or equal to 2. So it'd be a lot easier to graph this if we wrote it in slope-intercept form, right? It's y by itself, so we'll add 4x to both sides. Y is greater than or equal to positive 4x plus 2. All right, so we'll graph the line. Got a y-intercept of 2, a slope of 4. That means we're going to go to the right 1 and up 4. So it's got a slope of 4, it's got a y-intercept of 2. Again, the points on this line are going to make both sides of this inequality equal to each other. Is that okay if they're equal to each other?
Yes.
So how do we indicate on the graph that that's okay?
Solid
line. Solid line. To figuring out which half, either above or below this line, is the blacked out half. Which half is it?
Above,
for the same reasons we just listed for this other guy here. Right? Y is greater, y is vertical. Vertically, the greater numbers come from above. So, what's the solution to this system of inequalities? What's that? There are infinite solutions. How can I see them? Where are they?
Where the orange and the black or blue, whatever you did, mix.
Makes a what?
Like, are overlapping each other.
Overlapping. So, right in, you're going to kind of use green to indicate where they're overlapping. They're overlapping here. Right. And that being there, out over there, there's just orange, just black. What about this point right here? Is that a solution?
No.
Yes.
Yes.
Oh, yes.
No. No.
Yes.
Is it, the question is it part of the black graph and the orange graph?
Yes.
Yes.
Is it part of the orange graph?
Oh, yes.
Yes.
Why?
Is it solid?
Solid line. Is it part of the black graph?
Yes.
Because?
It's the shaded area.
In the shaded area. And this one, though?
No.
No.
No. It's, it seems like it's the same, except for it's not part of the black graph, because?
It's on the dotted
line.
Line.
Okay.
And, just a quick, what about right there on the intersection of the two lines?
No.
No. It's okay for the orange, but the, again, the black is the dotted line, so it does not. Good. Next question. Josie.
Number 14.
14 is one. Okay. So let's try and make this quick. There's a plane and it's flying. Okay. At first, it's flying upwind. What does upwind mean? Does it mean you're fighting the wind or the wind is helping you?
Fighting.
You're fighting it. Upwind is the same as upriver, right? You're going against the flow. So here comes the wind this direction. So that describes the first trip. Heads directly upwind to an airport 30 miles away. So the distance from where the plane starts to ends is 30 miles. It takes 30 minutes to get there. So this trip takes 30 minutes. The return trip takes 25 minutes. So a lot of the stuff is the same on the return trip. The wind's blowing just as hard. The plane is trying just as hard as it was. Like if the wind was still both ways, it would have taken the same amount of time, right?
Yeah.
The plane would have flown the same speed. But when it's fighting the wind, it takes longer. When the wind is helping, it doesn't take as long, right? So the wind is now helping the plane on the return trip. And that trip takes 25 minutes.
A pretty slow plane. Okay.
What's the speed of the wind? So how fast is the wind going? So okay. Well, the plane has a speed, right?
Yeah.
Like, if there was no wind, we could just look at the plane and look at its speedometer and see how fast it's going and just know how fast the plane is going, right? But we don't know that just from this information, because we only know how fast the plane can go fighting the wind and how fast the plane can go when it's going faster than it usually could, because the wind is helping. But the wind is blowing the same speed. The plane has the same effort given into it, has the same speed. The distance is the same, but the combined speeds for both the trips are different. Okay, the time is different. Okay. So it seemed to me we have a speed of the plane and the speed of the wind, and they're fighting each other. Here they're helping each other. So, Sean, what do you think?
I think the way I'm thinking of it is probably not the correct way, but probably the right. I think I'll get the right answer anyways.
Okay, let's see.
I know that 30 minutes and 30 miles would be equal to 60 miles per hour.
Okay, not bad to know how fast this thing is going, 60 miles per hour, right? A mile a minute.
And if 25 minutes is still 30 miles, then you would multiply by 2, both of them, and then get 50 miles per hour. The next one, that one might be longer, I'm not sure.
That doesn't quite work. It worked this one because 30 minutes was half an hour, but this is not half an hour, so there's not a multiplying by 2 here.
Okay.
But we do have miles per hour, right? So let's just take miles divided by how many hours have passed. So we got 30 miles. How many hours is 25 minutes?
It's like less than just a half.
Yeah, a little bit less than a half.
5/12, okay.
5/12. So 5 minutes is a 12th of an hour.
Yeah.
Is that right? Is 5 minutes a 12th of an hour?
Yeah.
And then there's 5 of those 5 minutes, right? For 25 minutes, 5 times 5.
Yeah.
So 5/12. 30 miles divided by 5/12 hours. Divided by a fraction, let's multiply by the reciprocal, 12 over 5. Okay, so 30 divided by 5 is 6, times 12 is 72 miles per hour. That's going to be, I think that'd be, you know, since we want to know the speed of the wind, right? How fast the wind is blowing. So if the speed, the plane's speed is x, and the wind's speed is y, well, this plane's speed would be x, and this wind's speed would be y still, just kind of going in the opposite direction. So let's look at this situation. We know that the overall speed is 72 miles per hour. How are the speed of the plane and the speed of the wind, like, combining in some way to create a 72 mile an hour speed? Yeah?
72 minus 60?
72 minus 60. These are two separate situations here. Here the plane is flying with the wind and achieving an overall speed of 72 miles an hour. Here it's fighting against the wind and getting a speed of 60 miles per hour. Let's think of it this way. Let's just make up some speeds. Let's say I'm the plane and I can fly 40 miles an hour. And if the wind is blowing 20 miles an hour, then how fast will I go if the wind is blowing on my back and I can go 40 and the wind is pushing 20 miles an hour? How fast would that be?
60
miles an hour, what do you guys think? If I can run 40, right, but I'm getting the help of wind that's blowing 20 miles an hour, that add up to 60 miles an hour?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, think of it this way. Say you're on a train. Trains travel along 60 miles an hour. You can throw a baseball 90 miles an hour. Okay? You're traveling 60, and you wind up and you throw that 90 mile an hour fastball. How fast is the ball actually going to someone who's just like standing over here on the ground, not on the train?
150.
150, right? 60 mile an hour train, 90 mile an hour fastball on the 60 mile an hour train, 150 miles an hour, right? When we put things together, we put a person on a train and they throw a fastball, the speed at which they throw the ball and the speed of the train add together. Maybe we put a plane on wind, like a person goes on a train, then we can essentially add their speeds together because it's riding along on that wind. So how do I put x and y together to get 72?
So you add them
together. X plus y equals 72. How are these speeds being combined together in this other situation to get 60 miles an hour? Subtracting. Which subtracting from which?
Y is subtracting itself from x.
Yes. The plane is flying. The wind is taking away from that speed, and the result is 60 miles an hour. Can you see how to solve this system?
Yeah.
What do we do?
Elimination.
Elimination. Look at that positive y, negative y. Could be easier, right? So what do we get here?
2x
equals
132.
These are both positive and we're adding everything together.
132.
X equals
66.
Yeah. 66. So what's that the speed of?
That's the speed of the
plane. I wrote the x next to the plane, so it would remind me. So, well, that means I need to find the speed of the wind because that's the question, so I can put it anywhere I want. I'll put the, right there. 66 plus the speed of the wind equals 72. Subtract 66 from 72, and we get what?
Six.
So the wind is blowing 6 miles an hour. The plane is flying 66 miles an hour. Other questions?
Oh, I just, are we going to go this way?